Friends, welcome back to the tetrahedron chemistry classes. So guys, in today's class I am going to take the concept of the effective nuclear charge and the Slater'S rules which are used to calculate the effective nuclear charge of the particular in the particular atom, right? So what is the concept you can see here? So before starting the lecture, you should know how actually why it is necessary to apply this effective nuclear charge concept. For example, say guys, you are having your sodium which is having the atomic number of 11, and if you write the electronic configuration right in this particular form, okay, so this is 281 electronic configuration, and if you want to write the shell, so this is the K shell, this is L shell, and this is M shell, right? This one is having the principal quantum number 1, this is having the principal quantum number 2, this is the principal quantum number 3, right? And now if you want to see, say in the center somewhere here, I am having the nucleus of the sodium, and say this is my first shell, and this first shell is having 2 electrons, so I can write 2 electrons here. And this is your second shell, and this shell, say this is L shell, it is having 8 number of electrons, so you can write 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. And in the last and in the outermost shell, you can see in the quantum number 3, you are having only 1 electron, right? Okay. And you know, when this atomic number is 11, it indicates that this molecule, or sorry, this sodium atom is having total 11 electrons present in these shells, and also it will also have protons. Okay, how many protons? 11 protons. So what will happen, you can see these 11 protons which are present in the nucleus of the sodium atom, they are attracting these 11 electrons which are present in the different shells of the sodium atom. Now the question is that, see, whether the positive charge which is due to the 11 electrons present in it, and you know the charge, how much charge would be there in the nucleus of the sodium atom. So you should multiply 11 with 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb to get the total positive value. But I am not giving you that particular value. I am only explaining you the concept actually. Okay. So this is the nucleus, and this sodium nucleus which is having the 11 proton, it is attracting the 11 electrons. Now the question comes, whether the influence of this these 11 protons would be equal on all these electrons present in the different shells, or it would be different. Obviously it would be different. How I can explain this difference, guys? It's very easy. You can see here, say somewhere here, you can see this is your principal quantum number 1. So this shell is very very close to the nucleus. Okay, this shell is very very close to the nucleus. That means these electrons are very tightly held by the nucleus. And when you go for the quantum number 2 for L shell, so 8 electrons. For these 8 electrons, the distance is quite large in that case when compared to the 2 electrons present in the A shell. So the influence of the 11 protons would be less on these 8 electrons present on the second shell of the sodium atom. Why? Because much of the power of the 11 protons are consumed by these 2 electrons for this attraction. So obviously for 8 electrons this power would be quite less. Now if you come here actually for the 11th electron, if you go for this one, principal quantum number 3, that is M shell, it is having only 1 electron. So obviously the 11 proton which are actually attracting the electrons, their influence, that means the influence of the protons would be very very less on the last electron which is present in the M shell. So what is happening, the nuclear charge, although it correspond to the 11 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb, but this magnitude is different for these 2 electrons and different for 8 electrons, and it could be, and it is even different or even less for this outermost electron. And this difference in the charge actually of the nuclei, which actually different electrons are feeling, is known as the effective nuclear charge. Now, simply you can say that how effectively the nuclear charge is pulling the electron towards itself. So this is the concept, right? So that's why we need to know the concept of the effective nuclear charge. So if you want to know the effective nuclear charge, the formula of effective nuclear charge, so it's very easy. You can write here. So I can write here. It is Z effective. I am writing it as Z effective. This would be equal to Z, right? And minus sigma, right? You can write sigma or you can write S for this one. Okay. So this sigma is what? This is actually your shielding constant. This is shielding constant or the screening constant, right? And this shielding constant actually is this shielding constant arises due to the repulsion between the electrons which are there in the different shells. So actually this shielding constant gives the value of the net repulsion, which this repulsion is in between the electron. And Z actually, which is positive charge present in the nuclei, it gives the magnitude of the attraction. Okay, so you should know this thing. So if you want to calculate the effective nuclear charge, that is Z effective, so you should know the shielding constant, right? So for to calculate this shielding constant, Slater gives some rules, and we will use these rules. Like you can see here, Slater's rule. I can write Slater's rule. Okay, so later on we will solve the problem based on this. Right now you can understand in that manner. If your electrons are present in the s and p orbital, that means if you are calculating the shielding constant for the electron which are present in the s and in the p orbital, so in that case the value for principal quantum number n, it would be 0.35. that means whatever the number of the electrons would be present on the s and p orbital, that number of electrons would be multiplied with this 0.35. okay. Now if the electron is present in the n minus 1 shell, that means the inner shell, that mean in that case you will multiply the number of electrons with this value, which is 0.85, and rest for all like n minus 2, n minus 3 and all, this value actually is only 1. Okay. And now a second thing, if your electrons say are present in the d orbital, okay, for example, say if electrons are present in the d or f orbitals, so I'm writing orbitals here, so I missed the orbitals here, okay. So in that case, when this happens actually, then the value of n would be 0.35. if you are calculating the shielding constant for the electron which is present on the d or the s d or the f orbitals, then you will actually see, then you will use that value 0.35. And for all others like n minus 1, n minus 2, n minus 3, for all these the value would be 1.0. Once you get this value, then you can very easily calculate. So now I am solving a numerical which has been asked in the previous year UTU BTech first year examination, and question was like that: calculate the effective nuclear charge for the peripheral electron of the nitrogen. So peripheral electron of the nitrogen, so I am making space here to calculate this particular problem. Say this is the nitrogen which is having the atomic number 7, so you can write 2 and 5, okay. And if you know, then you can group it together, 1s2, 2s2 and 2p3, okay. And you know the peripheral electron is the electron which is present in the outermost shell, or the valence electron, okay. So you are calculating the Z effective nuclear charge for one of the electron which is present in the 2p orbital, okay. So since you are interested in the 2p orbital, right, so this particular shell, right, this one, see, this is the principal quantum number 2, this is the principal quantum number 2, so this is your n shell actually, okay. And inner one is your n minus 1 shell. This is how you can write. And if you want to calculate the shielding constant, then this would be sigma equals to, okay. So you are calculating for one of the p electrons, so one electron would be your reference electron, And for that electron, you are calculating the repulsion. So you will exclude that electron from here. So it should be remembered, if five electrons are present here and you are calculating for one of them, so you will take only four electrons. In some cases, if only four electrons are present and you are calculating the for the peripheral electron, so you will actually subtract one from the four and you will calculate for the three electrons. So since I am calculating for the p electron, so one electron would be my reference electron. So in n shell, I am having only four electrons. So what I can do, I can multiply the value of four, and electrons are present in the s and p orbital. So I can multiply that value of four with 0.35. So I think there is no problem in that. Okay. And then plus. Then this is your n minus 1 shell, and in the n minus 1 shell, how many electrons are you are having? You are having only 2 electrons, and then this 2 the electron present in the s orbital, and this is your n minus 1, right? So for n minus 1, you will multiply that value with 0.85. So if you calculate this value, this would come around somewhere around 3.10. Okay, so this is the value of the sigma. And if you want to calculate the Z effective, right, for Z effective, okay, that value is actually Z minus sigma. Z is what? The atomic number of your nitrogen atom. So this is 7. So 7 minus 3.10, and this will give you 3.90. So this is the effective nuclear charge of the nitrogen nucleus, which actually pulls this outermost electron of the, see this fifth electron, this fifth electron of the nitrogen. So this is the shielding constant. Obviously this value would be different for the other electrons. And then again I am taking the next example, right? And again this example is from your YouTube examination. Calculate the effective nuclear charge for your peripheral electron present in the chromium atom. So you can write the chromium is 24, and if you write the electronic configuration, then you will find this is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, sorry, not yes, 3p6, and then you will have the 3d5, and then you will have 4s1. So it's a special case, okay? And if you are calculating for the peripheral electron, that means you are calculating for this s electron, okay? So for this s electron, you can write in that manner, you are calculating for this one. So this is your n shell, okay? This is the principal quantum number 4, say 3 3 3. This is the principal quantum number 2. So this is actually all these three will make your n minus 1 shell, okay? And this is principal quantum number 2. This will make your n minus 2. And the last one will make your n minus 3. Okay. Now you can calculate the value for this one also. How you can calculate the value? It's very easy. So you are calculating for the 4s electron. So this is your reference electron, and it will not, you will not take this electron in the account. So you will forget about this electron. Now you will calculate the sigma. Okay. The shielding constant. That would be equal to, see, now electron is present in the s orbital. So for s orbital it is 0.35, but we are not having any extra electron in the 0.35. So its value would be 0. So we will not take this 0.35 here. Now this is n minus 1. So in the n minus 1, we will multiply that value with the 0.85. So you can write 0.85 here. How many electrons are there? 6 to 8, 5, 13. So this would be multiplied with 13. Okay. And for, you can see, for rest of n minus 2, n minus 3 and so on, for all these actually, see this is n minus 2, this is n minus 3, for all these the value is only 1. So you will add this value plus, and how many electrons are there? 6 to 8 to 10. So you will multiply with this 10 into 1, and if you solve this value, right, then it would come around somewhere around 21.05. okay, so this is the shielding constant which I have calculated. So if you want to calculate the Z effective for this one, right, so Z effective would be Z minus shielding constant, and in that case Z, that is the atomic number of the chromium, it is 24, and you will subtract that value with the 21.05, and this will give you 2.95. so this is the shielding constant actually for the peripheral electron. So this is the second problem. So I'm taking next example to make the things lot clearer, right? Say now, say this time you are having bromine atom, right? Okay, and you know the bromine is having the atomic number of 35. You can write the electronic configuration in that manner: 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 4s2, 3d10, and 4p5. Okay, so this is the electronic configuration which is written here, and you have to calculate, say, for one of the 3d electron. Okay, you have to calculate for one of the 3d electron. So calculate Z effective for one of the 3d electron. So now it's very simple to calculate. So first of all, what I can do, I can rearrange these electrons or electronic configuration, right? So how I can rearrange, say this is 1s2, this is 2s2, this is 2p6, 3s2, this is 3p6, then I am writing 3d10, okay, then 4s2 and 4p5. In that manner actually I can rearrange. So see, I have to calculate the Z effective for the electron which is present in the d subshell. So I will ignore all the electrons which are present on the right hand side. So they are the outermost electron, and you know the outermost electrons actually do not do any kind of the shielding. So when they are not able to do the shield the electrons, so they will be ignored in the calculation. So see, again I can explain you from here. Earlier I have taken this particular example, sodium atom you are having. So see, these two electrons actually which are present in the K shell, they are shielding the these 8 electrons which are present in the L shell, right? And these 10 electrons which are present in the K and the L shell, they are shielding the electron of the M shell electron, your M shell electron, right? So outermost electron, see, if you want to know this extra outermost electron, whether it is shielding any electron, no, it is not shielding, because outside there is no electron, right? Say, for example, if you want to know the shielding constant, and if you want to calculate the Z effective by using the Slater's rule, then always in you will ignore all the right hand side electrons, actually right hand side electrons which are actually just adjacent to the electron which is your under investigation electron. So your under investigation electron is the electron which is present in the 3d10 shell, so there is no meaning of including those electrons here. So if you want to calculate, see, now what you can do, you can make a group of these orbitals. So how you can make the group, see, this is you can see the 3d shell. So I am taking this d orbital separately, okay, and then these two I am taking here, then this is principal counter number 2 and this is the principal counter number 1. Sir, you are interested in the 3d electron, okay? So this 3d is actually what, this is your n shell, okay, this is your n shell, and rest all see, for this this is your n minus 1 and this is your n minus 2. So if you want to calculate the shielding constant, so that would be equals to, see, how many electrons are there present in the D? 10 electrons. But out of these 10 electrons, one electron would be my reference electron. So total electron present in it only, we will take only 9 electrons. Okay, 9 into, and we will multiply that value with the 0.35. Okay, why 0.35? You can see here, when you are calculating for the electrons which are present in the d or in the f orbital, then the n, for n shell you will take the value of the 0.35, okay, and then 9, this is your actual, these are your 9 electrons which are present here. Now rest electron you can count, 6 to 8, 8 and to 10 plus 6, 16, 18. Now you left with the 18 electron, right? So those 18 electron multiplied by 1 only, okay? So you will multiply with 1 only. Why? Because whenever the electron present in the n minus 1, n minus 2 and n minus 3 electron, so you will multiply that value with the 1 only, okay? So when you will multiply with the 1, so this, if you calculate, this would come around somewhere around 21.15. so if you want to calculate the Z effective, you know Z effective, 35 is the atomic number for the bromine, right? and you will subtract that value from here, 221.15, and that value would be 13.85. So this is how you can calculate the shielding constant. And in that case, this example is actually the different one, because I am calculating for the 3D, so you will ignore all these electrons. And one more confusion which you can have here, right? See, when electron is present in the D, then you will multiply that value with the 0.35. So this is your N shell. Now you can say, see guys, this 3 and this 3, they are also actually the N shell, right? But whenever we have the different orbitals, S and P orbital, then you will take your D orbital separately and S and P orbital separately, and these S and P orbitals actually are all your N minus 1. So you will multiply this, you will multiply this value only with the 1 and 9 with this one, while you will ignore rest of the 7 electrons. So this is how you can calculate the shielding constant for the bromine also. Okay.